That's true. In this video, we're going to talk about rationalizing the square roots from denominators when the denominator of your fraction is a monomial, a collection of just numbers and variables that are being multiplied together. In a following video, we're going to rationalize the denominator, the square roots from denominators, when the denominator is a binomial. That's when you have two terms separated by an addition or subtraction sign. But for this video, when the denominators are just monomials, we're going to simplify the numerator and denominator as much as possible. We're going to then look at the denominator at the bottom of our fractions, and if there's any square roots left, we're going to multiply the top and bottom of the fraction by that square root. And we are just doing square roots. We're not going to be trying to rationalize third roots, fourth roots, fifth roots. That's a bit more of an advanced concept, which will come in a later video. And once we multiply top and bottom of our fraction, the numerator and denominator, by that square root, we're going to just simply resimplify again, and we'll be done. So let's see what those three examples are going to look like. Here's our three examples. With increasing difficulty, we have 3 over square root of 2. We're supposed to simplify, but the numerator only has 3, and the denominator is square root of 2, and there is no perfect square, which is a factor of 2, so there's no simplifying required here. We're just going to identify the square root that's in the denominator and multiply it to the numerator and the denominator and resimplify. So we're going to multiply top and bottom by square root of 2. That is going to give us 3 square root of 2 over square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 4, and the square root of 4 is equal to 2. And now we're supposed to resimplify, but there's nothing left to do. The 3 and the 2, there's no cancellation that's going to happen there. I don't want a decimal. I don't want this rewritten as 1.5. So that's done. Our second example, again, just with pure numbers, we have 5 over the square root of 50. Now, I could multiply top and bottom by the square root of 50, but my number's going to get bigger than necessary. So I'm going to follow my directions, which was simplify the numerator and denominator as much as possible. Well, how am I going to simplify this? If you go to simplify radicals, you try and factor the values that are inside that square root symbol with factors which themselves are perfect squares. And there is a perfect square in 50. Now, our perfect squares, again, are 2 squared, which is 4. That's the first real usable perfect square. So is 1. So we have 2 squared, which is 4. We have 3 squared, which is 9. We have 4 squared, which is 16. And then we have 25, which is 5 squared. So I'm going to rewrite this as 5 over, and I'm going to split this again, factor it so that one of my factors is a perfect square, which is going to be the square root of 25 times the square root of 2. Now, the square root of 25 is 5, so now we come down to here and we have 5 over the square root of 25, which is 5, square root of 2. And sometimes I can simplify now like I will. Sometimes you might not have any kind of cancellation that will happen until later on in the problem. But we do have a 5 on the top and bottom of our fraction now, so we can go ahead and cancel that out if we like. And, 5 divided by 5 is 1. You can cancel out factors. So we end up with 1 over square root of 2. And when you're done simplifying as much as possible, you multiply the numerator and denominator by the square root that you still have left in the denominator. So we're going to multiply top and bottom by square root of 2 and get 1 times square root of 2 is square root of 2. Just highlight our final answer in white. And square root of 2 times square root of 2 is square root of 4. And the square root of 4 is, again, equal to 2. Now, we have the same number showing up on the top and bottom like we had here with the 5s. I cannot cancel these out because it's square root of 2. This 2 is inside of a math function, whereas in the denominator it's just by itself, just hanging out. So these do not cancel out. This is done as much as it's going to be. Now we have a relatively difficult example of when you have a monomial in the denominator. There's no plus or minus, so it's one term in the denominator. And we're going to see what happens here. We're going to simplify as much as we can. Now, my textbook, again, if you've been watching my videos about simplifying square roots, handles the variables as if they can be any real number. So, when we have a base and its power is exactly a match to the index, The answer is just fine. It's just A if our exponent is odd, but if our exponent is even, we need to put in an absolute value just to make sure we indicate that, you know, our answer doesn't imply that we have are able to square root a negative number. And I have a numerical example of why this is in a video, but I'm just going to use this rule our book has with our example to make sure we have all the absolute values in the right spot. Okay, so we're going to simplify this as much as possible. Okay, and if you're not sure how to simplify this, watch my video simplifying square roots with variables. So I've got 20. Now there's a perfect square in 20. I could factor 20 as being 2 times 10, but 2 is not a perfect square, neither is 10, so that's not very helpful. But I can write it as the square root of 4, which is a perfect square, times the square root of 5, and then we have the square root, I'm given all the numbers and variables around square root symbol, so the square root of x squared, and in the denominator, I've got the square root of y to the 4th, and the square root of z. Now, you might know that the square root of y to the 4th is equal to y squared, but I'm going to go ahead and rewrite this a little bit to get it to match this sort of like, hey, don't forget this note that my textbook likes to remind us about when you need to include the absolute values in your answers and when you don't. So I'm going to rewrite this one more step and have it square root of 4, square root of 5, square root of x squared, and I want to rewrite y to the 4th as y squared squared. Now, this is power to power, remember? And when you have stacked exponents, you would multiply those. So if I were to re-simplify this, y squared squared, that's power to power, and 2 times 2 is equal to 4. And again, I'm doing this so that I can have a base with a power of 2 because I've got an index of 2 in my square root and I want to see that perfect match so I know whether I need to include an absolute value or not. And then we have the square root of z. So I'm still just very, very small steps simplifying this problem. So the square root of 4 is 2, coming down over here. The square root of 5 is nothing's going to happen there. Now this is a square root with a exponent of 2, and if n is even, I need to include my absolute value symbol. So this is going to be 2 times the absolute value of x, because this square root is going to take that power of 2 and divide it by 2, or just simply cancel it, as you're hopefully used to seeing by now. And so the square root of x squared is x, and in the absolute value symbol, because n is even, square root of 5. Same thing down here. N and my index are even, and so I'm going to write the absolute value of y squared, because these will cancel out, leave me with y squared, and the square root of z. Okay, before I actually rationalize this denominator, I can come in here and erase the absolute values that are around y squared. The purpose of an absolute value, again, is to see how far a number is away from zero on the number line, but in algebra it just seems to make the negatives disappear. So the absolute value is preventing this factor from being negative. Well, if I take a number and I square it, a positive number squared is positive, and if y happens to be negative and I square it, it's still going to come out to be positive. So my absolute value symbols here, because this has an even power still left, is and that even power will cancel the negative out if y happens to be negative, it's unnecessary now. So here's my simplified expression. I have a square root of z in the denominator. I'm going to multiply top and bottom by z to get that rationalization step done. And my final answer is going to be 2 absolute value of x, square root of 5 times square root of z is square root of 5z, and square root of z times square root of z is going to be the square root of z squared. I multiply them together, it's going to be positive, so I can just say it's y squared z. Now, if your textbook is not, when you look in the back as you're simplifying these radicals and you're not seeing absolute value symbols show up in these problems where you're simplifying radicals. That means that your textbook is assuming that all your variables are positive real numbers as opposed to all real numbers. Maybe that might be for an Algebra 1 book or something like that. But my textbook emphasizes this because it's allowing the variables to represent all real numbers. If you do not see these in your answers in the back of your book, and if your teacher's not throwing these absolute value symbols in every now and then maybe this is just a touch more advanced than what you're doing in your textbook, so don't worry about it. Just drop the absolute value symbols and you'll be done. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.